whose throne forever reigns. God in the highest, worthy to merit our praise.
Take your Bible to Genesis chapter 15. Genesis chapter 15. Now I know that we're probably in about the fourth quarter of the Cowboy game about now. And I also know that it's 6:09, that it's the first pitch of the Astros game. So I wouldn't go either way for the Cowboys, but I'm an Astros fan. And I plan to watch that game. I hope the Lord moves and I'm not there at 6:09, but if I can be, I will be. And I will enjoy that. But I'm going to try to fix it to where you can. Everybody but Keith and Judy. Now, they got to drive to Woden, so I can't quit in time for them to get to Woden. But if you live toward Diboll like I do, I'm going to try to give you a fighting chance to get there on time for that ball game. Now, don't mark it down and don't crucify me if we don't, but I'm going to try. I'm going to try. Genesis, the 15th chapter, the first six verses, the Bible says, "After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, 'Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward.' But Abram said, 'Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. That's a question he's asking God. Then Abram said, look, you've given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, speaking of Eliezer. Said, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your body shall be your heir. Then he, God, brought him, Abram, outside, and he said, look now toward heaven, and count the stars if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And Abram believed in the Lord, and he, God, accounted it to him for righteousness. Now, every year when school starts, we always hear that little adage of the three R's. One of them is there's only really one R, but we say it and it sounds like three R's: reading, writing, and arithmetic. Now, tonight I'm going to give you concerning this word of God that God has for Abram. He's going to give him three F's. So this word from God is going to be a word about Abram's fear, about Abram's future, and about Abram's faith. So he's going to speak to those three things. And you say, well, you know, I've heard a lot of words from a lot of different people. I'm going to tell you that what Abram hears from God, it changes his life. It changed his life, and it doesn't just change it temporarily for a week or for a month or even for a year, but it changed his life forever. He receives a word from God, and it revolutionizes the remainder of his life. And I tell you tonight that of all of the possessions, I don't know what your greatest, most prized possessions may be, and those are things that we put up on the mantelpiece or we put in the lockbox, but of all of the possessions, I really believe this with all my heart, the greatest possession that we have, aside from our salvation, is the Word of God. It's the Word of God. We have the opportunity to sit daily with the entire counsel of God's Word. When Paul would write many of those Old Testament letters, he didn't sit in the prison cell with an entire council of the Word of God because he was the author of much of that. And when we read about these characters, they didn't have that opportunity to sit with the entire council of the Word of God. But we have that privilege. So we have the opportunity daily to, just as in this passage, God had a word for Abram, God has a word for us. And tonight I want us to look at this word that he has for Abram and see how or see what it is that God can teach us about our walk with God. So he's going to begin with these three things. The first F that this word addresses is Abram's fear. It's Abram's fear. Now here's the way verse 1 begins. He says, after these things. Now what things would these be? I believe that it would be the entirety of the 14th chapter. Now, we've been about 3 weeks, I think it was, or so, covering that period of time, and it would have been that whole ordeal about the Dead Sea War and Abram's defeat of Cheddar Cheese, King Cheddar Cheese, however you say his real name, and it had to do with that and how he defeated his allies. He had audiences with kings and he had all of these things. Well, that's what this is addressing. He said, after all of that has happened. Now, here's what he says. It's after those things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision saying, do not be afraid. Now you say, now Brother Steve, didn't Abram win that battle against those kings? You remember, Abram only had an army of about, if I can remember, it's 300 and some. I think it's 318-man army. The other armies, they were much larger. They were much in number. They were far superior to Abram's. And what Abram had to fear was that some of those could come back in reprisal against him. So he is living with the thought that Abram doesn't have a many, many man army that is standing guard and standing watch over him 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You think about it in the case of our president, regardless of who it is. There's never a moment when he is unguarded. There's never a moment when there's not a uniformed military person standing at the door with some kind of machine guns that are guarding the gates, and you don't get in without... Abram doesn't have all of this. And Abram is living in fear, if you would, of those whom he has defeated, of them gathering back together and coming. So God speaks to that. And he speaks to it with that little phrase, do not be afraid. Now, the phrase, do not be afraid, fear not. I don't know if this is true because I'll be honest, I didn't sit down and count them, but I remember reading this, and it may have been on the internet somewhere, that there are 365 fear nots in the Bible. Now, there are only 68 or 69 times where the Bible says the words fear not. It's only 60 some odd times. But sometimes it says, do not be afraid. Sometimes it says that meaning in some different words. And I don't know if there's 365 of them or not. But I do know this, that this is the first time that phrase is ever spoken in Scripture. Do not be afraid, or fear not, depending on your translation. So he says, don't be afraid, Abram. He said, I'm your shield. Now that's pertinent because Abram could be living in fear because these other armies whom he has defeated in the past chapter, they could come back. So he lets Abram know. He says, I'm your shield. And he said, and also your exceedingly great reward. Well, what does Abram get from all of this? What does Abram get from knowing God? Well, he gets three P's. One, he gets peace from knowing God. He gets peace. Again, first time these words, fear not, or some derivative thereof, is used in the Bible. But it's not going to be the last. We're going to find that phrase repeated and repeated and repeated, and it goes all the way through to the book of Revelation. Now there are a lot of people in our life, they'll come through and they'll say, don't be afraid, don't fear, all of these kind of things. But I'm telling you, when you hear those words from God, it's something different. And God comes to Abram in this vision, and God says, Abram, don't fear. Fear not. Don't be afraid, Abram. Men may encourage us to live without fear, to fear not. But when it comes from God, it has great power. If you remember the disciples in John the 6th chapter, beginning with the 16th verse, the disciples are in the ship, and Jesus comes out and he begins to come to their vessel, and you get down, I'm not going to read that whole passage, but you get down to the 19th verse. I'll pick up reading there. It says, so when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near their boat, and they were afraid. And verse 20 says, but Jesus said to them, it is I. And then what did he say? Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. So when we're going through, and we go through them, we go through storms, don't we? We go through difficulties, we go through trying times, and we go through fearful times. Well, here's the secret to that. When we're going through those times, the secret is to let God on board with us. Because where he is, fear has to flee. And that's what he says to Abram. Well, Abram not only got peace in this word, he also, in knowing God, he also got protection. Now, that was that little phrase about, I am your shield. I'm your shield. Now, Abram probably felt almost like, have you ever felt like a sitting duck? Some of you guys that were military, you could have been in a, I've never been military, But you could have been in a situation where you kind of felt unguarded from the back or the side or whatever. You just sort of felt like a sitting duck. Well, Abram very likely could have felt like a sitting duck. He's living in this place called Hebron. He doesn't have a massive army that's standing watch and standing guard over him all day long. This camp that he would have, this compound, it would be more, according to the commentaries that I read, they said it would be more like a big ranch than it would have been like a compound or a defensive place. And he didn't really have a protection there. So God speaks to the fear that Abram has, and he says, Abram, I'm your protection. I'm your protection. You say, Rusty, what does that tell us today? It tells us this. I don't know, and listen, I'm thankful for this. I'm thankful for every dollar that we spend for our military. I'm thankful for every dollar that we spend to pay those men and women who go off and protect us. But I'm also going to tell you this. We can have the biggest army that money can buy. We can have the greatest weapons that money could get a hold of. But I'm telling you, if God is not our shield, we're in trouble. And God's telling Abram. He said, Abram, I'm paraphrasing this just in case you start looking for it and it's not there. He said, Abram, just because there's not a big army all around this compound, and just because there's not a great wall that somebody would have to come over, he said, Abram, I'm your shield. I'm your shield, and I will take care of you. And listen, to those of us who belong to the Lord, we too are sheltered by the Lord. Listen to what the Bible says in Psalm 34:7. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him. And then it adds one more statement in that verse. And he delivers them. Then the Bible says in Colossians 3:3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Listen, the laws of our nation, I agree that we were founded as a Christian nation. But you look at a lot of the laws that come down the pike these days, and you look at a lot of the things that come down that we say are okay, and our laws and many of our statutes in the United States of America are telling God, we don't need you. In fact, some of them are saying, we don't want you. But I'm telling you, without him, we're sunk. We're sunk. So he tells Abram, he says, there's peace in knowing God, there's protection in knowing God, and then he speaks of a prize that comes from knowing God. Now, we remember, we go back to when the word of the Lord came to Abram the very first time back in the 12th chapter. And we find out that Abram is a man who left his home, he left his family to follow the Lord. And the Lord told him even then, he says, here's some things that I'm going to do. Well, up until this point, none of those things have happened. None of those things have begun to come to fruition. One commentator, he said, there hasn't even been the slightest hint of all of the things that God had promised Abram that they were going to happen. Well, we also remember last chapter, in the 14th chapter, that one of the kings came, the king of Sodom came to him in the 21st verse of the previous chapter and told him, he says, here, you can have all of the riches of one of these places. And remember what Abram said? He said, uh-uh. He said, uh-uh. So Abram has given up a lot from those things. And we would say that, man, we would almost refer to him as a martyr. But here's what happens. God comes by to remind Abram, I know you left your family. I know you left your home. I know you left all of those things. I know you turned down all of those things. But he comes by to remind Abram that if one, and he's speaking to Abram here, but if one has the Lord, he has everything. If one has the Lord, they possess everything. Listen, there is not an earthly treasure If we could have, I don't know who the richest man in America, I don't know who the richest man in the world is, but if we had his bank account, if we had his home, if we had all of the things that constitute the wealth and the riches of this world, but we didn't have our Lord, we wouldn't have much. I'm telling you tonight, when we have the love of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God, and the salvation, the forgiveness, the presence, the peace, the power, heaven, hope, and the list could go on and on and on. We quickly find out that we have things that all of the money in Bill Gates' bank account can't buy. So God comes by and He reminds him, there's a great prize in knowing God. The child of God is not to be pitied. The child of God is to be envied for what we have in this relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So He speaks to Abram's fear. Then He speaks about Abram's future. Now He begins this in the second verse. Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. Now, we'll read verse 4 and 5 in a minute. Now, here's what Abram is concerned about. Abram is concerned. Abram is concerned, and Abram is burdened, and Abram is 100% human. That means he's 100% us. Now, I can't speak for you. I can only speak for me. But if I'd left home, if I'd left family, if I'd left friends, if I'd left all those things, and because God had promised me these things, and here I am, this span of time has come later, I'm going to stick a word in there that I oftentimes feel this word, and I'm sure that you don't, but it would be the word discouraged. Discouraged. Now, Abram comes, he's concerned, he's burdened, he's discouraged a little bit. Maybe there's a twinge of hopelessness because all of these promises that he has received, that it hadn't happened. It hasn't come to fruition. So he begins to question. And listen, I don't think God is beset by our questions because I believe that God knows that we are fully human. And as humans, His ways are not our ways, His thoughts are not our thoughts, and all of those things. So God knows that we don't understand things the way that He does. So I don't think that when we have questions, I don't think it besets God. I don't think it causes an uproar in heaven. Oh my goodness, Brother Steve had a question. I don't think that happens. So He has these questions, and they're honest questions. I don't think they're necessarily questions about doubt. They're just honest questions. Things that he's going to do. So he pours his heart out to God. And here's the good thing about that, is Abram knew where to take his questions. It wasn't to the gossip committee. It wasn't in our day, it would be to the send it out over the Facebook. He took them to God. He took his questions to God, and as a result, he received the answers to the questions that he sought. So here's what God does. He gives him, it's talking about this word, is about Abram's future, what's going to happen in the days to come. So God is going to speak about the simplicity of God's promise. Here's the fourth verse. And behold, the word of the Lord came to Abram, saying, this one, and that's the one whom he has spoken about, this Eliezer of Damascus, this one shall not be your heir. But one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Now, is there any room in that statement from God that would cause Abram to walk off somewhere and say, well, here's what God said. What do you reckon he meant? He didn't have to go to the committee down at the church and say, guys, this is the answer God gave. Help me to understand. No, it was a clear, simple, straightforward answer that was given in simple and clear terms, and he is assured once again. Now let's remember, Abram's an old man. And what was happening with Abram is what's happening with all of us every day. He wasn't getting any younger. And Sarah, she was old too. And she wasn't getting any younger. So here's what God does, is he assures Abram again that he will have a son, and that this son, not this Eliezer, who Eliezer is just the chief servant. And it was customary in this day that if a man didn't have an heir, that he would sort of adopt one of his servants to be that heir. And God says, no, that's not the plan. He says, you are going to have a son, and that son will be your heir. Now, listen. The Word of God, there's some things. In fact, somebody asked me a question before church tonight. There are just some things that I can read, and there's some things that I can preach that I don't necessarily have the answer or understand all there is to understand about it. In fact, if you had to understand all that there is to understand about it, there's only about three things that I could preach about. And that'd get pretty old pretty fast. Well, but if you think about the Word of God in a lot of places, There are more places than not that God just speaks very clearly in His Word. There's not things that we have to have a business meeting. We don't need to call the association together and let's sit down and hash out as to what God meant, because most of the time He just speaks in clear, concise, and simple terms. That this is what we're supposed to do, or this is what we're not supposed to do. And that's what God does here. He says, Abram, he says, I know you're old. He says, I know you're getting older. He says, I know you're past the time of normal time of giving birth to a son. He said, I know all of those things, but that's what's going to happen for you. That's what's going to happen. So it was a simple promise. And then he spoke of the sovereignty of this promise. Here's the fifth verse added to the fourth. Then he brought him outside. God brought Abram outside and said, look now toward heaven and count the stars if you're able to number them. And God said to Abram, now think about this. Abram is concerned about how many descendants? One. God is talking about the number of descendants that Abram will not even be able to count. Here's what he said, and he said to him, just like the stars in the heaven, so shall your descendants be. You know what that speaks of? That promise that God made speaks of the power. The power of God. He's an old man, Abram is, and he's past the time. But God's going to do something that almost defies what we would call the normal laws of nature. And God's going to do something that, and listen, we remember this about him. We all change, okay? There are very few people that you run across in your life that you can say they almost look just like they did as you seen them the first time 40 years ago. There's not many. I'm not one of those people. Okay? I don't remember what I looked like 40 years ago, but it wasn't this. Now, the first pastor that I, the first full-time pastor I ever worked with, Bud McGee. Bud McGee, he's aged in the last few years, but he's getting close to 80 years old now. But up until then, Bud McGee looked almost the same as he did the very first time that I ever seen him some 30 years ago. Now, here's what we need to remember. Our God, the God that we serve, the God that is speaking to Abraham, our God is an able God. He is an able God. Remember what the Bible says in Ephesians 3:20? It says there, now to Him, and that's speaking of our Lord, who is able to do what? exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. We need to remember that He is a God who operates not in the realm of most power, but He is a God who operates in the realm of all power. The Scripture says in Matthew 28:18, Jesus comes in and He speaks to him and He makes this statement. He says, all authority, not some, not a little bit, not a good bit, not most, all authority has been given to me in heaven and in earth. Luke 1:37 makes this statement, for with God, what will be impossible? Nothing. Nothing will be impossible. All things are possible with the Lord. We need to remember, we don't serve a God who can do. We serve a God who has done. That's who we serve. So then he speaks about the size of God's promise. He brings him outside and he says, Abram, look up there in the sky. And he says, count the stars if you're able. Now, you remember as a kid, did you ever try to count them? You ever take off on a trip? And we did that. You know, we didn't have video players in the car and only had an AM radio. I remember that. Some of you remember not having a radio at all. But we'd say, we're going to count the stars. So we'd look out our little window and we'd begin to count. And you didn't have to get very high before you didn't know if you'd counted that one or not. So you lose count and the game changes pretty soon to something else. But I just Googled the question, just sitting at my desk this afternoon. I Googled the question, how many stars are in our galaxy? That would just be our little cul-de-sac in this vast universe. I can't verify this answer, or I don't guess you could unverify it. But here's what came up as an answer to that question. 100,000 million stars in our galaxy. Now, I don't know how many galaxies that there are, but that's the size of God's promise. He says, Abram, go outside and look toward the heaven and count the stars if you're Abram, able to do so. And then he said, so shall your descendants be. Abram is concerned with one heir, and God is concerned about giving him more heirs than he will ever be able to count. So God's promise was humongous. It was humongous. So he gives him a word about his fear. He gives him a word about his future, and he gives him a word about his faith. In the sixth verse, here's what it says. And Abram believed in the Lord, and he, the Lord, accounted it to Abram, or counted it to him for righteousness. Now, this is one of the simplest yet greatest verses in the entire Word of God. And listen, what it teaches us about Abram's faith, it ought to be true. I pray it's true of your faith and my faith today. So it speaks about three things. It talks about the direction of Abram's faith. It's that little word in. He believed in the Lord, and that little word in, it is sort of that little saying, it tells the tale. You see, Abram has moved beyond hearing the word of the Lord and believing the promises of the Lord, and he has moved into the realm of casting himself totally in faith upon the Lord. He doesn't just believe the word anymore. He believes God. It's kind of like Job. In Job, the 13th chapter and the 15th verse, Job made this statement, speaking of the Lord. He said, though he slay me, he said, I'll still trust him. Though he slay me, yet I will trust him. Even so, I will defend my own ways before me. So Abram's faith is in the Lord. It's in the Lord. And I would pose the question tonight. Has your faith made the transition? Has your faith made the transition from just hearing the promises and reading the promises into casting yourselves upon the promises in faith in the Word of God. So he talked about the direction of his faith. Then he talked about the depth of his faith. Now Abram has some obstacles to what he's going to do. And Abram, he believes in spite of the obstacles that are there. Now you think about this. What do you think if Abram goes out and he's, you know, if Carolyn's his neighbor, and he goes out and he's well up in years and he says, "Hey, Carolyn," he says, me and old Sarah, we're going to have a baby." Now here's what, Carolyn, she's a wonderful woman, but if she had been his neighbor back in this day, she'd have said, she had got her phone, she had a text Charlotte, and she says, "Charlotte," she said, "old crazy Abram, he just came outside and he told me that him and Sarah was going to have a baby." So there's all these people, and they're hearing what Abram says. And I don't know how you say this in the Hebrew or the Greek or the Aramaic or any other language that's used throughout the Word of God, but they would have said something akin to the fact that he's cuckoo. He's loco. He's crazy. They thought he was a fool when he began talking about what he believed that God was going to do, because that's what God said he was going to do. But even though there were obstacles, even though people laughed at him, even though people scoffed at him, even though people, they might have made fun of him, you know what Abram did? He still believed and trusted in God. That's what he did. He still trusted in God. And listen, that's the kind of faith that we need. We need a faith, and listen, it's not going to get any better until Jesus comes. People are going to, and thank God we live in the deep south Bible Belt. But there are places in America that we would get laughed in our face for faith in God. And they would laugh at us and they would scoff at us, and the challenge would be for us to hang in there and still believe in God. Our faith has to be deep. And the nearer we get to the day of our Lord Jesus Christ, we better be growing our faith, because it's going to get harder. And it's going to get harder. It's the direction of his faith, the depth of his faith, and then the dividend of his faith. Listen. Faith in God always pays off. Faith in God, and listen, it doesn't just pay off, it pays big. And Abram's faith was no exception. When Abram believed God, think about what happens. Go back when you were saved. It wasn't a matter of just a Sunday night. Steve walked down the aisle and shook the preacher's hand and went off with Brother Hall, and he shared the scripture with me, and same service that night. It was kind of the precursor to the everything in one service. You walk the aisle, you get saved and get baptized all in the same service. Well, that's the way it happened with me. But here's what really happened. All of my sin was erased. It was done away with, and God took Abram's sin, and he had some. And he erased his sin, and God applied his perfect righteousness. That's what the scripture says. God accounted it to Abram for righteousness. And that's what God does with us, is he imputes the righteousness of his Son to us. And when he sees us, he doesn't see Steve. He doesn't see my shortcomings, and he doesn't see my bad habits, and he doesn't see those things, but he sees the righteousness of his dear Son, Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, man, faith in God pays off big time. Big time. Now, that was a pretty neat day when the Lord spoke to Abram. I wonder tonight, because he's the same. Now, he has never verbally spoken to me, but he still speaks to us. Speaks to us through the Holy Spirit. Speaks to us through his Word. And I wonder tonight, has God spoken to us? tonight. You see, we all, and to think otherwise, we would be amiss. Every one of us in this room, from the front to the back, we all have, we'll just call them needs, situations in our life. And every one of those, I have people all the time, they'll send me a note or they'll tell me something and say, "Preacher, we got this going on and that going on." And I'll be honest, I try to remember them. I try to jot myself a note if I can remember to do that. But if I don't, I'm probably not going to remember that. But I'm going to tell you something. God knows. He knows everything that's going on in everybody's life. He knows where your needs are. He knows what your needs are. And I'm telling you, some way or another, this I don't understand, and I don't know how it happens, but God can take, whether it be a Sunday school lesson or a preached message, He can take a passage of Scripture and the preached, taught Word of God, and He can speak to a need that would be true in Sue's life, that would be A, and He could speak to a need in Charlotte's life that's totally over here in this other county on the other side of this building. It would be not even similar in kind, and He could take His Word and He could speak to both of those needs. So you know what that tells me tonight? Is it tells me tonight that God could have spoken to a need in your life and in mine. It could be that there's just something in our life that we need peace about it. He is our peace. It may be something in our life where we just need the protection of life and some storm we're in. He was Abram's shield. He's our shield. It's not changed. He's our shield. And listen, he wants to do all of these things. He knows the areas of our life where we just need a sovereign God to move. And it may well be tonight that He is speaking to your heart about that need. And if He is, you listen. Because He spoke to Abram, and Abram listened. And it revolutionized Abram's life. And when God speaks and when God moves, it will still revolutionize your life and mine. So if God speaks to us tonight through the Holy Spirit of God, through the Word of God, listen and move accordingly. Let's pray. Father, thank You. Thank You for Your Word. Thank You for Your presence. Thank You for the opportunity that You've granted us tonight to come to Your house. Lord, tonight You know all of the needs and all of the things that are represented in all of our lives. You know the things that we're dealing with. You know the things that we may be discouraged about. You know the things that the circumstances that we're dealing with. And God, whatever that need may be, that You would speak peace and You would speak provision into all of those circumstances. God, I pray tonight that we wouldn't just leave here saying that we're a people of faith, but we would leave here exemplifying and demonstrating that we have faith in a living God who loves and cares for His people. Bless this invitation. Speak to our hearts. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.